that in addition to lots of articles, chapters, all that kind of stuff, she's edited or co-edited a half dozen different books, and this is in addition to her two major books, the first in 1991, Publishing and Cultural Politics, and then 10 years later, The Other Enlightenment, How French Women Became Modern. Carla has also been the recipient of some of the highest honors that our profession bestows, including fellowships from the American Council of Learned Societies, the Guggenheim Foundation, and one that she has in common with her mentor, our own Professor John Beecher, who's off in France at the moment and couldn't be present, the Palmes Académiques, which is awarded on behalf of the French nation. So I could go on at further length about what is a spectacular career on the part of this individual who has established herself as a world-class historian in what I would claim is among the very most competitive branches of the discipline of history, namely the study of the French Revolution. But there is one credential, and you've already heard about it, that I think recommends her particularly to this audience, and that is the fact that not so very long ago, at least as I measure time, being an older professor, Carla would have been sitting here in the audience rather than up at the desk, because she was indeed one of our own undergraduates who received her BA degree from Santa Cruz, a double major in history and French literature, with, I might add, honors in history. So she's really ours, I think. whom we have therefore brought to address us today on a day that's really dedicated to the achievements of our history majors. So who better to deliver the keynote address than this distinguished alumna who the Department of History takes special pride in. For her talk today, Carla has come up with the following intriguing title. Is Baudelaire in that data set? My undergraduate life as a double agent in the humanities and social sciences. So please join me in welcoming Carla Hesse.
Well, thank you, Mark. And of course, it's extremely moving for me to be here. I haven't been here in a very long time, and I also haven't seen many of my old friends in a long time. And it makes me feel a little less old that you're still here. So that's great. Mark asked me to do a little bit of telling of war stories and a little bit of serious intellectual substance, and after those four marvelous papers, I feel a little bit like I should be giving more intellectual substance to this talk, but I hope you'll find something in it that you can take away. So how did I become a historian of the French Revolution? I hate to tell you, it was not through my undergraduate research experience. I guess thankfully it had already happened to me, and one thing that struck me today listening to many of the talks this morning is how generations find their topics. And if the topic for this generation is, as I think one of your professors said, empire and nation and encounter, for my generation, that is to say, a young person who grew up in Berkeley in the 60s, it was revolution, absolutely. So revolution found me, and I think your topic probably found you too, at least in that most general sense. And I didn't find France that way either. Through revolution, I found it because I had the happy experience of landing on the Boulevard Saint-Michel at the age of 16 and never recovered, as any sane young person would respond in the same way, I'm sure. So by the time I came to Santa Cruz, revolution, that is to say, how societies come unraveled and how they put themselves back together again, was something I felt like I'd lived and needed to understand growing up in Berkeley and actually having tanks running down the streets of Berkeley in my childhood. But when I came to Santa Cruz, it was everything Europe and everything French that interested me. And of course, that led me to some suspects who were in this room, as well as others, Jonathan Beecher, Terry Burke, Mark Traugott. I took every possible French history course I could find, and also to the French department, where I studied with Christine Breitenbach most intensively, and among others, who was in medieval and Renaissance literature, and Nan Rosenthal, who many might remember, some from those years would remember, who was an extremely charismatic art historian and scholar of the French artist Yves Klein. So I ended up becoming a double major because it was French, really, and things French that fascinated me. And by my senior year, I was working for three of these professors: Mark Traugott, Nan Rosenthal in art history, and Christine Breitenbach in French literature. And they all sort of became keys to what ended up being my concentration, which is on the 19th century and on the revolution. And I won't go through all of the various trajectories by which that all kind of cohered into an interest in and a focus on the 19th century and revolution, but it was the century, after all, of revolution and, not incidentally for me, poetry. And so that was how I came to start to shape my research interests as an undergraduate. And I was led into various aspects of exploring this through my professors here. And Santa Cruz, I want to say, in the late 70s, which is when I was here, was a kind of storm center for this kind of interdisciplinary exploration of problems and topics. There were multiple intellectual impulses that were informing my fascination. Of course, social history was at its absolute heyday here, and in the history profession in general, and especially in the French history profession, when the Annales school was really in its heyday, and big quantitative history, major structural insights into especially pre-modern society, was the center of historical conversation in France. And I was introduced to that kind of quantitative research through all of my professors here, but it was with Mark Traugott that I got my hands dirty in this the field of that, of doing quantitative history. I'll come back to this in a moment. That's the data set part of my title. The other mainstream that was running through my undergraduate experience here was what became later known as the interpretive or discursive turn in history. That is to say, the turn toward intellectual history and, in more fancy jargon, the history of discourse. This was the moment in which Michel Foucault's works were translated into English in the late 70s, and they were beginning to make their ways all the way to the West Coast and up this mountain. In fact, I drove with some professors here to go hear Michel Foucault speak at Stanford. And so the problem of this interpretive turn, or history as the interpretation of discourses rather than as the empirical research for facts, was also an important current, and one that resonated and spoke to my interests in literature. And so this was a kind of perfect synthetic moment for me, and history ended up being, he's right, the center of that, because history was, of course, and still is, the synthetic discipline par excellence, where I could explore both quantitative and sociological analysis at the same time as doing work in interpretation and bring my literary skills to the interpretation of historical texts. But this all, in a kind of on-the-ground way, really did begin with Mark Traugott and punch cards, which is a word that probably some of you have heard, but that was the one PowerPoint image I did want to bring, just because it's an artifact and a document, and it's already history, so to speak. But Mark was working on his book on the armies of the poor at the time, and I became his research assistant, and I did grunt work for him, which meant I sorted punch cards. And as you all may remember, some of you remember what those looked like. They were the primitive form of early computing and quantitative research. And I had boxes of these, and he was having me sort them so that they could then be fed into machines. And I was at that time living at Nan Rosenthal's house as her research assistant, and she had a sort of in-law apartment, and working for her. And I pulled this box of punch cards out, and I was sorting them on the table, and she walked in and said, "Is Baudelaire in that data set?" And I looked up, kind of getting vaguely pale and losing blood from my head, and said, "Well, probably." It was all of the survey and demographic data for Paris in 1848, which he had carefully coded sociologically by social classes and occupations. And occupational stratification was a critical element of his interpretation of political behavior in 1848. And so I kind of palely said this And of course, it went against everything that Nan Rosenthal was thinking about at the time, who had me working in a completely opposite direction on sort of the early 19th century origins of the anti-realist movement in French painting through Marcel Duchamp, and I wrote a major research paper for her on Duchamp, up all the way up to her major subject, which was Yves Klein, the painter of blue. And so from the Impressionists to the Abstract Expressionists, at the center of Rosenthal's project was the problem of the artist in the age of mechanical reproduction. What did it mean to, what was the status of individual expression in this moment of routinization that we have come to know as the Industrial Age? So there I was, kind of split and driven, you know, and they should have strung me up and done something to me. But in any event, they rescued me, the two of them, really, by sending me to Paris in different ways. Nan Rosenthal, because I was able to work for her and save up the money to go to Paris in the summer of 1978, and Mark Traugott, because from his, I'm sure, modest grant, paid me a little bit of money while I was in Paris to work for him that summer, and that really was a revolutionary moment for me. Why? Because he went out and gathered data by looking at a lot of survey material every day, and he sent me on wild goose chases for him, which was the most marvelous gift anyone could have given an undergraduate researcher, which is to say, I got all the long shots, things he didn't think were going to pan out. And he gave me a list of names of people he was hoping to find out more biographical information on, and who were actors in 1848, and particularly counter-revolutionary workers, which was the center, as I'm sure many of you know, of his research at the time. Why did workers become anti-revolutionary? What were the variables? And so he gave me this list of names to track, and I would go from archive to archive, repository to repository that held papers on 1848, day in and day out, taking the metro, learning everything about Paris, and learning really everything about Parisian archives, which was a gift that has lasted me my whole lifetime. And finally, I landed in the police archives, which are still in the 5th arrondissement in Paris, and that was the epiphanic moment. Bingo, I found one of Professor Traugott's counter-revolutionary workers, and with the assistance, I might say, of some very nice French policemen who thought it was extremely amusing to find an 18-year-old girl from California who was interested in 1848. And they promptly corrupted me by taking me out for coffee and introduced me to smoking cigarettes, which mercifully I've abandoned later in life. But more important than finding one of these names, I found more about them. I discovered that this man was a double, indeed a triple agent. I can't remember his name now, and I don't think it mattered to you very much, actually. But he was not only a member of the Garde Mobile, but he was also a member of several revolutionary clubs, and he worked for the police, which is why I found him, because he was an undercover cop. And so there was a synthetic moment for me, an individual subject, a triple agent, behind the numbers that Professor Traugott was crunching. Now, my favorite book as an undergraduate, and I think that when I had my Fulbright interview when I was graduating, they asked you what were your three favorite books, and my favorite book was Karl Marx's 18th Brumaire, which of course I learned to love from Jonathan Beecher. And I still love that book the most because it is the book that explores the problem of self-reflexivity in a moment of revolutionary mobilization. What does it mean to become conscious of oneself as a political actor, or to fail to become conscious of oneself as a political actor? And this was absolutely at the center of my conundrum between the data set and Baudelaire. And I saw in that book, and I still see in that book, the possibility of writing a history that would solve my problem. History that would be a dialectic between meaning and experience. History that would allow me to look at individual subjects and their lives and the kind of meanings that they produced, as well as the objective constraints and institutions under which they produced them. Well, that at least provided me with a path forward, but I have to say that that work on 1848 and that summer of research didn't solve my career problems at all. I came back to California equally as confused as I was when I left, and promptly applied to graduate school in literature, in history. So I wasn't quite there yet, Mark. I hadn't quite. And as my and many of your parents, I'm sure, wish, I applied to law school as well, just to, you know, keep my bases covered. And when the envelopes started coming in, some rejecting me, some accepting me, on the thin and the thick, over the course of that spring and summer, it was the envelope from Princeton to study history that grabbed my heart. And that, not surprisingly, because again, it was the envelope that allowed me not to solve my problem, which I think is the moral of the lecture I want to give today, or I am in the process of giving to you today, which is that the choice of history was, in effect, a choice not to make a choice between the different modes of interpreting the past that I had been introduced to as an undergraduate. It was the discipline that welcomed disciplinary heterodoxy that would allow me to continue to pursue both these trajectories of research, the problem of power as a form of constraint, and the problem of individual creativity as a force of transformation. So, it was a choice not to solve my career problems, and I have to say that 30, ouch, years later, I think we're about there, and three books later, having just finished nearly the third of them on the French Revolution, I still haven't solved my problems at all. And I can intend fully not to solve them. I'm completely committed to dying with this unsolved problem of trying to understand human experience as it emerges in both its objective and subjective dimensions. And I guess what I want to say about undergraduate research and listening today to the topics that have found you, and I think will continue to find you whether you end up going to law school or not, I think they will chase you down, is that the research work I did for all of my professors, both as a student and also as a research assistant, and really what it gave me was not a subject, which I'd already in some deep sense found in my own historical moment, but it gave me enduring ways to think about that subject. In that sense, it was getting the fishing rod rather than the fish. And so I just want to thank you, and I'm looking forward to hearing the rest of the papers today, and I hope we can continue to discuss them at the end.